Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. My name is Angie Smith, and I'm the director of the Roger Mudd Center for Ethics. I'd like to welcome all of you to this year's Mudd Distinguished Lecture in Ethics. Now, before we begin, the staff of Lee Chapel has asked me to announce that should an emergency arise, there is an additional emergency exit at the bottom of the stairwell located behind me to the right. So we have a very full auditorium today, which is fantastic. And just know if there's any problem, you can go out this way too. So this is the third year of programming for the Mudd Center, a center whose existence was made possible through a generous gift from our distinguished 1950 alumnus, Roger Mudd. Though Roger was unfortunately unable to join us here today, I would still like to take a moment to express my sincere appreciation to him for all he has done to support and encourage the study of public and professional ethics at this university. Before introducing our distinguished lecturer, I would also like to take a little bit of time just to talk about the series that his lecture is kicking off. Each year, the Mudd Center chooses a general topic in public or professional ethics to explore throughout the year through a series of lectures, seminars, conferences, and other events. The topic we have chosen for this year is markets and morals. This topic seems particularly fitting at a time when increasing numbers of Americans are expressing concerns about rising economic inequality, about the scope and limits of markets, and about the ethical obligations of both corporations and consumers in our market-based economy. I've placed some brochures in the back that list the upcoming events in this series, but let me just highlight a few of the events we have coming up this fall. At the end of this month, we will be hosting an interdisciplinary conference on the ethics of environmental valuation, which will bring together philosophers, economists, and environmental scientists to discuss ethical issues surrounding the valuation of ecosystem services. In early November, our very own professor of art history, George Bent, will be giving a lunchtime talk on artistic depictions of the rise of capitalism in medieval Florence. And in mid-November, Duke Law professor Kim Krawiec will talk with us about taboo trades in the human body. Finally, in early December, Harvard professor of business administration, Nianha She, will be giving a lecture on the responsibilities of global business leaders. We also have a full lineup of exciting events in the winter, including a major conference on the ethics of acquiring cultural heritage objects in early March. I encourage you to go to the Mudd Center webpage to learn more about all of these upcoming events. So let me turn now to introducing this year's Mudd Distinguished Lecturer in Ethics. It is an honor and a real privilege to be able to welcome Professor Peter Singer here to give the keynote lecture for this year's Mudd Center series. As I'm sure all of you here know, Professor Singer is one of the most important and influential philosophers in the world today. As a philosopher myself, I can attest to the fact that it is quite rare for individuals in our field to achieve worldwide recognition and acclaim. What is even more rare, however, is for a philosopher to have had such a profound impact on the course of public affairs. In a career that has spanned over 40 years, Professor Singer has been at the forefront of several important social and political movements, including the modern animal welfare movement and the growing effective altruism movement that is working toward the eradication of global poverty. As he wrote in his famous 1972 essay, Famine, Affluence, and Morality, quote, "What is the point of relating philosophy to public and personal affairs if we do not take our conclusions seriously? In this instance, taking our conclusions seriously means acting on it," end quote. More than any philosopher I can think of, Professor Singer has acted on his conclusions and has thereby made a positive difference in the lives of countless of our fellow creatures. Professor Singer is the Ira W. DeCamp Professor of Bioethics in the University Center for Human Values at Princeton University, and a laureate professor at the Center for Applied Philosophy and Public Ethics at the University of Melbourne. He first became well known internationally after the publication of his 1975 book, Animal Liberation, which has now sold well over 500,000 copies. Since that time, he has written, co-authored, or edited over 30 additional books, including Practical Ethics, One World, The Ethics of Globalization, The Life You Can Save, Acting Now to End World Poverty, and The Most Good You Can Do, How Effective Altruism is Changing Ideas About Living Ethically, which came out in 2015. His books have been published in 15 languages, and Practical Ethics is Cambridge University Press's most profitable philosophy text to date. His most recent book, Ethics in the Real World, 82 Brief Essays on Things That Matter, just came out this month. Several of these books, including his newest one, are available for purchase in our university bookstore, and I highly encourage you to go pick those up. Professor Singer has received numerous awards and honors for his work, and in 2005 was named one of the most influential people in the world by Time magazine. In 2012, he received Australia's highest civic honor when he was appointed Companion of the Order of Australia for, and I quote, eminent service to philosophy and bioethics as a leader of public ethics and communicator of ideas in the areas of global poverty, animal welfare, and the human condition, end quote. We are very fortunate to have Professor Singer with us here today. His lecture is entitled, Permitting the Sale of Meat, but Not Kidneys or Sex, Some Questions About Markets and Morals. Please join me in welcoming him to Washington and Lee.
Thank you very much for that welcome and that very generous introduction. And I do applaud what you're doing with the Mudd Center for Ethics because, as you just said, I do think that ethics is really important. I think that ethics is not merely an academic study of theories, but something that ought to make a difference to the way we live. And I've been really pleased throughout my career to see that it does make that difference, to see that it changes the lives of people who come across ideas in philosophy courses and then think about how that can be something that they actually live by. What I'm going to talk about today, though, in the theme that you referred to of markets and morals, are three rather different things that might come under markets, and in terms of things that are likely to change our lives, it's perhaps only when I get to questions about whether there should be a market for meat that I'll touch upon one of those issues that's been close to the center of what I've been working on since at least 1975. What I have, as the topic suggests, is three different areas, where two of which a market is prohibited, at least in this country, that is a market for kidneys and a market for sex, and one in which it is allowed, in fact taken for granted, there's not really any serious questions about it, and I want to raise some questions about all three of those, whether in fact we've made the right choices in terms of what we permit and don't permit in all three of those cases. I'm going to start with the two where we do not presently allow markets and raise some questions about them. In general, let me say, though, that I think the market has shown itself to be an effective way of allowing supply and demand to match each other and to distribute goods in accordance with people's preferences. So I think we could start with, if you like, a market as a kind of default position for how we ought to distribute goods and services, unless there are some arguments against doing so. And if there are arguments against doing so, then we need to weigh those arguments with the arguments in favor of doing so. Now, let me start with kidneys. Kidneys, in common with other organs in this country, following the passage of the National Organ Transplant Act in 1984, cannot be bought and sold in the United States, and with one exception, that is true worldwide in terms of legally being able to be bought and sold. And I'll come to that exception later on. A question that is raised about this arises because of the growing need for organs, and in particular for kidneys, as a result of the increasing rate of end-stage renal disease, which is increasing because of increasing rates of diabetes. That's a major cause of end-stage renal disease. You can think of, call it kidney failure, if you like, a simpler term than end-stage renal disease, and also high blood pressure. And a kidney donation is the preferred solution. If you can't find a relative or a friend who will donate a kidney to you, then the only option is to go on dialysis and to add your name to the waiting list of people to receive an organ, not from a relative or friend, that is not from a living donor generally, but from usually from a deceased donor. Although there is a very small number of living donors who have altruistically donated kidneys, not to a relative or friend, but to a stranger. But in general, most of the supply for those on the waiting list comes from people who die and have consented to their organs being removed. Now, if you're on the waiting list, you're on dialysis. Dialysis offers a poor quality of life. If you know anyone on dialysis, I'm pretty sure that they will agree with that, and a substantially reduced life expectancy. So if you go on dialysis in your 40s, for example, when you might normally have a life expectancy of 35 to 40 years, and you're on dialysis, your life expectancy is probably somewhere not more than 15 years. So quite a substantial reduction in life expectancy, and as I say, poor quality of life, so you wait and hope for a transplant. But there is a waiting list, and the waiting list is currently over 100,000 people. And it's not getting any shorter. In 2009, the National Kidney Foundation launched a 10-year campaign with the goal of getting the average waiting period, which was then 2.8 years, down to a year. How successful has that campaign been? Well, the current average waiting period is over 4 years. We're not quite at 2019 yet, but I think it's very unlikely that that campaign is going to succeed in the next 3 years. The reason for that is that roughly 35,000 people are added to the waiting list each year. About 17,000 receive a donation, and about 7,000 either die or become so seriously ill that they are taken off the waiting list. They're no longer candidates to receive it. So you can do the math. It's pretty clear that the list is growing by more than 10,000 each year. And the cost of this is staggering, because some years ago, Congress, in its infinite wisdom, decided that everybody who needs dialysis was going to get it. As a result of a protest of people in need of dialysis, it decided that you would get that irrespective of financial ability to pay for it or insurance. It's one of the few things that for which there is universal healthcare coverage in this country. And as a result of that, Medicare is currently spending 7% of its total budget on dialysis alone. That's an enormous sum. So it's very expensive, poor quality of life, and some people are dying because they're not getting an organ. As I said, 7,000 people either die or they become too ill to receive an organ. Now, I'm not saying that all of those die because they didn't get an organ. Clearly, you know, some people will die anyway from other causes. We don't actually have good statistics on how many of them die because they didn't get an organ, would have lived if they had. You know, we could guess, say, somewhere in the middle. Let's say somewhere around 3,000. If that's so, then what we're talking about annually is a death toll that is similar to that of September 11th, 2001, one of the blackest days in this country's history. We're doing a great deal, of course, to try to prevent a recurrence of the events of September 11, 2001. Anybody who ever flies has first-hand knowledge of one of the things that we're doing to prevent that happening again. It's inconvenient, it's costly, but we're doing it. But there is, I think, a rather simple solution, less costly solution, in fact, a money-saving solution, to the number of people who are dying because they can't get kidneys. As I said, since the passage of the National Organ Transplant Act, payment for organs has been illegal, and the Act is standardly interpreted as ruling out other incentives as well. For example, providing lifelong free health care of the sort that veterans get. We could amend the National Organ Transplant Act and save thousands of lives a year. And when you think about it, what stands against that? After all, if an organ transplant is done, then almost everybody involved gets paid. The surgeon gets paid, the nephrologist, the kidney specialist gets paid, the hospital gets paid, the nursing staff get paid. Only the donor doesn't get paid. And yet the donor is particularly crucial. As I said, the donor may or may not be alive, but the donor can't be paid, nor can the donor's family. Well, why not? Probably what you think of when I ask that question is you think of the illegal black market for organs that exists in poor countries such as the Philippines and India, and you may have seen or read about people who have sold their organs for not very much money, have had poor healthcare treatment, not had good surgery, not had good recovery after the surgery, and have regretted having sold their organs. But of course, you can't compare what would happen in a market that was legal, an open market, with a black market. We know that from many other instances. So it's not really a good indication of what would happen if we did allow compensation for organ donations here. Are there any legal market models that we can look at? There is, as I said, one country in the world that allows payment for organs. And if you don't already know this, you're not going to be able to guess which country it is, because it's not a country that you would think of either as in the forefront of laissez-faire neoliberal economics, regulating a market, nor in general as a country with particularly progressive social policies. The country is Iran. Iran is the only place where you can legally, openly sell a kidney, and Iran has no waiting list, or virtually no waiting list, for people in need of kidneys. It's not exactly a free market. The government sets a price for the kidneys. The person who wants to sell goes to a charity. There are regulated charities for patients receiving organs, and goes through counseling and says if he or she is willing to sell the organ at the price. Part of the price is paid by the government. The rest has to be made up by the patient. But if the patient is poor, the charity will try and raise funds to pay the rest. Sometimes it's able to do so, not always. So it's a regulated market, and there have been some studies written about it. Generally, people seem to be reasonably happy with it. But it's perhaps not the same as it would be here. Should we simply have a completely free market? I think that would be risky. I'm not advocating a free market for kidneys. I think there's a risk that people in great need would sell an organ, receive a lump sum in cash, spend it unwisely, and then be no better off than they were before. I can see an argument for that. You know, again, a sort of doctrinaire, laissez-faire, free market person could say, well, why interfere with that? People can make their choices, and if they make them badly, that happens. But I think we can do better. And I think in terms of practice of proposing a feasible and politically acceptable reform, we would do better if we think, at least at first, about trialing some longer-term benefits. I've already mentioned giving organ donors lifetime free health coverage of a high quality. There are other things that one could do as well. One could, for example, pay them an annuity so they can't spend everything at once, that they will get an annual payment for their organ. We could give them priority to receive an organ, or them and their families priority to receive an organ if they should need an organ. Or we could pay money into their IRA, their retirement account. So there are various things we could do that would make it a long-term benefit. The sum that they get overall could be paid for from Medicare or from private health insurers, since both Medicare and Medicaid and private health insurance are currently paying an enormous amount, as I said, for dialysis. In fact, the cost of dialysis is being estimated at around $80,000 per year. And as I said, people on dialysis might live for 15 years. So you could very easily take $100,000 and use that for the cost of the transplant, paying some of it to the surgeon, some of it to the hospital, and perhaps leaving, let's say, $80,000 for the kidney donor or vendor, if you prefer. That's quite a substantial sum for people who are poor. It could make a significant difference. And of course, they could have counseling beforehand. There could be a cooling off period. That is, they can't just rush in and say, I want to do this and do it the next day. There could be a month or 3 months, whatever, where they reflect on their decision and decide whether they want to go ahead with it. This seems to me to be something that would be worthwhile piloting, perhaps in some states rather than nationally, to see how it works. It would have the great advantage, as I said, of saving lives and improving quality of life, reducing healthcare costs. It would reduce the demand for black market organs from unprotected people in developing countries. And it would provide substantial assets to poorer people who would benefit from them over their entire life. What's wrong with it then? Well, some people will say it's going to exploit the poor. Not only do we take things from them in various ways, make them work in poorly paid jobs, dangerous conditions, and so on, but now we're going to take their bodily parts as well. But remember, this is offering them a choice that they can reflect on, that they can be counseled on. If they don't get $80,000 in this way, or as an annuity or whatever, they're going to have to get money somehow. We don't provide them with adequate minimal income, so they're going to have to work at unpleasant jobs. Those jobs might be more unpleasant to them than giving up a kidney, which, by the way, is a pretty safe procedure. The chances of dying as a result of donating a kidney are estimated to be about 1 in 3,000. So it's generally a safe procedure. They're going to suffer perhaps various health hazards through their workplace. So it offers them a choice. Followers of the 18th century German philosopher Immanuel Kant might say it's using them as a means, but why is it using them as a means to offer them the opportunity to sell an organ rather than using them as a means to offer them the opportunity to work in a dusty, polluted factory where they're doing hard physical labor? I don't think you can draw a very meaningful distinction between one and the other in terms of using people as means. And the thing to remember here, above all, is, as I say, that this will save lives. Saving lives is generally considered a high priority. You need to have really solid, clear arguments to outweigh the, I would say, certainty in this case that this reform would save lives. I don't think the arguments against it are anything like as clear-cut as that. So there's a circumstance in which I think we could go more in the direction of markets from where we are now. Okay. There's a saying that prostitution is the world's oldest profession. I don't like the term prostitution. It's unnecessarily pejorative. I think we should use the term sex work, refer to people who work in that industry as sex workers. But it certainly is an old profession. And it's interesting that attitudes to the criminalization of sex work are starting to change. So there are quite a number of countries in which the sex industry has been legalized. When I say the sex industry has been legalized, I mean the consensual exchange of sexual services between consenting adults for remuneration. So I'm not talking about trafficking. Trafficking generally refers to coerced sex workers, people who are not consenting to being in that profession, usually young girls, but of course sex workers can be male or transgender as well. And we're focusing on consensual exchange of sexual services for money. And as I said, this is now legal in a number of countries. I'll mention some of those shortly. And interestingly, Amnesty International, which is an organization that stands up for the rights of people who are being oppressed, earlier this year in May, adopted a policy calling for the repeal of all laws that criminalize sex work as I have defined it. Now, when Amnesty announced that it was planning to adopt that policy, it caused a storm of opposition from some feminist organizations who accused it of protecting the rights of pimps and johns. The correct strategy, some of them argued, was instead to end the demand for paid sex. That's like saying that the way to stop rape is to end the desire of some men to have sex with women, whether or not the women consent to it, or perhaps, in some cases, especially when the women do not consent to it. Stopping that desire sounds great. I'm sure we would all endorse the idea that that desire should be stopped. But how? How do you do that? It doesn't really seem that education is going to be the full answer. It may be a part of the answer, but some desires go so deep that education is not going to eliminate them entirely from, in this case, the male population. And now that I've mentioned rape, there is a possible connection with the criminalization of sex work. It's long been speculated that allowing sex work reduces the incidence of rape. In fact, Thomas Aquinas, the great medieval Catholic theologian, in his Summa Theologica, said that it is a sin to engage in what he called harlotry, that is, to be paid for sex. It's a sin, but he argued against its prohibition, saying that if you do away with harlots, the world will be convulsed with lust. Well, it's an interesting image, but whatever exactly that means, one of the possible consequences of a world convulsed with lust is that there is more violence against women directed at obtaining sex from them, in other words, rape. And in fact, an interesting natural experiment occurred not that long ago in the state of Rhode Island. In 1980, legislators changed legislation about criminalizing the sex industry. And inadvertently, they changed some words which actually legalized the sex industry as long as it was off the street. So they continued to be prohibited, street walking continued to be prohibited, and of course trafficking continued to be prohibited. But off the street sex in brothels or massage parlors, they inadvertently decriminalized. They didn't realize this for 23 years until a court case was taken in 2003 against a massage parlor, and no conviction was able to be recorded because of the change in the legislation. It then took them a further 6 years to actually bring back the old prohibition. And after that court case in 2003, of course, it became well known that you could legally operate a brothel off the street. So during that 6 years, the sex industry was effectively legalized in Rhode Island, and a study of that period has shown that rapes reported to police fell by 31%. In fact, Rhode Island is not a very large state, but there were 824 fewer rapes reported to the police than you would have expected prior to that. And as many rapes go unreported, presumably there's a larger overall reduction. So that's pretty significant. Something like 1,000 fewer rapes in a small state like Rhode Island, that is a big gain. Now, you know, that's one study. Obviously, there's more research. But I think it's not implausible that allowing men to pay for sex may reduce the incidence of coerced sex. But in any case, apart from that, if you care about the rights and welfare of the sex workers themselves and their safety, you should support moves to decriminalize sex work. And that's why it's odd, I think, that feminist organizations, or at least some of them, have opposed decriminalization. In the same month that Amnesty International adopted its policy of decriminalization, for example, the government of the Australian state of New South Wales, which had already decriminalized the sex industry, but had then elected a more conservative government, that government, after an inquiry into whether it should recriminalize or in some way further regulate the sex industry in that state, decided not to do so. And the sex workers in New South Wales have the Australian Sex Workers Association, in other words, effectively a union of sex workers, also known as the Scarlet Alliance. And the CEO of that association greeted the news with relief, saying that decriminalization had delivered, and I quote, outstanding outcomes for sex workers' health and safety. It said that it enabled sex workers to be covered by the standard regulations of all work, including insurance, occupational health and safety programs, and fair trading regulations. So there are significant benefits for people in the industry from decriminalization. They're more free to report violence or to report being cheated out of their proper earnings or working in unsafe conditions. A further side benefit, and in fact the reason why the industry was originally decriminalized in New South Wales, was that an inquiry had shown that many of the New South Wales police force were on the take from brothels. Since they didn't really think that this was in itself a bad thing, they were quite happy to take bribes in order to not raid the brothels. But once you get corruption and bribery getting into the police force, obviously it doesn't just stop at what I would say are relatively harmless activities like brothels, but moves on to drugs and various other areas. Police who take bribes are clearly vulnerable to be blackmailed in other ways. So there are serious problems. So I think that although legalizing sex work may not save as many lives as legalizing compensation for organ donors, I do think it would save some, the lives of sex workers who will be better protected from violence, and the lives of some women who might have been raped and killed had paid sex been available, might not have been raped and killed had paid sex been available. Of course, you could say, yes, but wouldn't it be a better world in which no one had to provide sex in order to earn money, in which everybody had a decent job, in which they could work without having to resort to sex? We presume that that's generally not something that women, or for that matter, men or other sex workers want to do. Sure, but again, we don't live in that world, and I don't see us living in that world in the next decade or two. There are lots of people who have to do unpleasant, dangerous work, and why should we not give them a choice as to whether they want to try and do that kind of work or whether they want perhaps to earn more money in fewer hours through paid sex? And here we do have models of countries rather like the United States that have a legal industry. As I said, some of the states of Australia, Canada, many nations in Europe, and even some parts of Nevada. And I hope I pronounced that correctly. I honestly don't see any strong reasons here against it, except a certain prudishness about discussing it and the fact that very few politicians want to put their hands up and say, I'm in favor of legalizing the sex industry. Okay, so those are the two areas where I want to move in a more market-friendly direction. Let me now come to the one where I don't. Markets generally work well when those participating in it are well informed, when they consent freely to the transactions that they're engaging in, and when there are no externalities. Externalities is a term that economists use to refer to effects that fall outside the parties to the exchange. So if I buy something from you, we're the two parties to the deal, we agree on a price, you wouldn't accept the price if you didn't think it was a reasonable price that you wanted to get for what you're selling me, I wouldn't pay it if I didn't think that it was worth it to me to pay that much for that amount. And if nobody else is affected, you know, significantly and adversely affected without their consent by this arrangement, then there's no externalities. But very often there are effects on third parties who are not part of the deal. And markets fail when there are serious externalities. And I think in this respect, the markets for meat and to some extent other animal products are a failure. They have dire effects on third parties. Let me begin with what I think is the most obvious externality of meat production, and this applies particularly to beef and dairy and to lamb as well. Essentially, these are ruminant animals. Ruminant animals produce large amounts of methane through their digestive processes. Methane is an extremely potent greenhouse gas. You can have debates about how much more potent it is than carbon dioxide. Let's say roughly 30 times would be a sort of average. Some people think significantly more. Some people think a little less. And it's a major contributor to climate change through greenhouse gas emissions. How big a contributor is it? Well, some years ago, the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization did an estimate in a report called Livestock's Long Shadow, where it said that the livestock industry is responsible for more greenhouse gases than the entire transport sector. So more greenhouse gases than all cars, trucks, ships, trains, and aeroplanes. That's pretty significant, about 18%, in fact. And the largest single source of greenhouse gases after power generation, after the stationary power industry. Some calculations have suggested that it's significantly higher than that in countries with a large beef herd, and this is a country with a large beef herd. So there was a study a few years ago which suggested that in the United States, emissions from greenhouse gas emissions from livestock could be as much as half of all US emissions. A number of other people criticized that study, said that it was taking things into account that it shouldn't have been, or not taking other things into account that it should have. So maybe that was too high. But still, even if we're down to 18, or if we're somewhere between 18 and 50%, it's a very large impact, and it clearly is an externality. The people who are affected by climate change are not parties to the transaction. They don't get anything out of it. When you go to the supermarket and buy beef, the supermarket gets some money out of it, the beef producer gets some money out of it, you get some meat out of it that you want to eat, but the people who are affected by climate change, whatever that might be, whether it's an intensification of hurricanes and may have contributed to the hurricane that we're just looking at in Haiti on the news now, we don't know. But certainly if the oceans get warmer, hurricanes will become more frequent and more intense. Also contributing to sea level rises, and if that happens, we're going to get coastal flooding to a greater extent. Will also contribute to rainfall variations, which will mean that people who rely on rainfall to grow their crops will be struggling, and if they're peasant farmers in developing countries relying on crops to feed themselves, they may well become climate refugees. All of these people are external to the transaction, but are affected by it. Now, perhaps some of you will be saying, I'm conscious of where I am, and I'm conscious that as I drove down from Washington, D.C., the only presidential election signs that I saw said Trump-Pence. So some of you may perhaps be skeptical about what I'm saying, about whether greenhouse gases are causing climate change, or whether it's all a Chinese hoax. But even if you are somewhat skeptical, suppose that there's only a 50% chance that the overwhelming majority of scientists are right on this. Suppose it's only a 50% chance. It still doesn't seem to me worth taking the risk. It's not worth risking conditions that will make life very tough for hundreds of millions, perhaps billions of people over coming decades in order to continue to eat beef rather than some plant-based form of protein. You have to compare what the costs and benefits are, even taking into account the risk. So that's why I think that's one reason why we should not be having an unregulated market in meat, and particularly in those meats that I mentioned, which have the highest greenhouse gas emissions. And by the way, some of you may say, well, when I buy beef, I only buy grass-fed beef. So that's good in terms of saving the waste of grain that goes into feeding grain to feedlot beefs. But it's no good at all in terms of greenhouse gases. In fact, it's slightly worse. The reason for that is, why do most beef producers feed grain to their cattle? Because the cattle put on weight faster. That's the economics of it. They can produce that quantity of beef quicker, so they get money back quicker. If they're grass-fed, they take longer. Per pound of beef, they have to eat longer. They have to spend more days on Earth. They have to eat more. They have to digest more. So they release more methane. So grass-fed beef might be good in some ways, probably a better life for the cattle, I would agree with that, but doesn't at all contribute to solving the problem of climate change. Makes it worse. Now, is that a reason for not having a market? Maybe not. But it would be a reason for, I would say, putting some disincentives on beef, buying beef, and using the revenue to counteract greenhouse gas emissions in other ways. So what I'm suggesting, perhaps, is either a tax on beef because of its high greenhouse gas emissions, or a cap and trade scheme, which has been talked about in general, though we don't have it in this country yet, but a cap and trade scheme which covers not just fossil fuel emissions, but also livestock emissions. And then the revenue in either of those ways could go to provide incentives for the use of solar generation or other ways of reducing greenhouse gas emissions. So you could still have a market, but it would not be an unregulated market as it is now. A second factor, though, that I want to mention, and this is really going to be my concluding point, a second factor in terms of externalities of markets has to ask, who are we counting as those who are affected by the markets? Standardly, we only count human beings. So I've been talking about externalities and how they're going to fall on people around the world who are going to be affected by climate change. But, of course, there are other sentient beings who are at the center of a market in meat. And they are the animals themselves who are killed in order to provide their meat, their flesh as meat. Should we consider that as an externality? Should we consider that the market is adversely affecting them? I believe that we should. To some extent, we already do, although we don't think of it in the terms that I've just mentioned. But we do regulate the meat market in the sense of having some, rather minimal unfortunately, anti-cruelty legislation. So for example, there is a federal Humane Slaughter Act, which says that animals must be rendered insensible before being killed. Unfortunately, it has one huge exception and one rather smaller exception. The smaller exception is for religious slaughter, halal or kosher slaughter. The huge exception is that although it isn't explicitly in the language of the Act, the US Department of Agriculture interprets it as not applying to birds. Now, in fact, birds, i.e. chickens and turkeys, and to some extent ducks, are actually the largest number by far of all the animals that are killed for meat in the United States. So they're not covered by the federal humane slaughter legislation. But the Act is an example of how we do, through anti-cruelty legislation, pay some regard to the interests of the animals who are part of that industry. I don't think that that's nearly enough. And I do think that we should consider the animals as other beings with lives to live whose interests count. And if the industry is harming them, then that's a bad thing. And I do think that in general, the industry clearly is harming them, because the majority of the animals that are raised for food in the United States are intensively raised, that is, they're factory farmed, they're confined in various ways. I've already mentioned beef cattle confined in feedlots, which is the majority of the beef cattle. But that's actually a relatively benign form of confinement compared to the confinement of chickens and pigs, who are far more crowded indoors in the ways that they're reared and far more stressed. And there are various ways of in which the suffering of chickens and pigs ought to be taken into account and are not taken into account. So the birds are, as I said, extremely crowded. If you've ever walked into a chicken shed, the first thing you'll notice is the atmosphere reeks of ammonia because the droppings are not cleaned out even between each flock of birds. The birds are killed very young. They're usually there only about 6 weeks, but the droppings will be there perhaps for a year at a time. So the ammonia fills the atmosphere. It's very unpleasant for the workers who have to go through, but it's much worse for the chickens who are there. Also, the birds have been bred to grow extremely fast. That's why they can be ready for market weight when they're essentially babies, just 6 weeks old. And because of that, their leg bones are not sufficiently strong to support them with comfort. So Professor John Webster, who's a professor of veterinary science at the University of Bristol in England and the founder of, I think, the largest or second largest animal welfare research center in the world, says that about a third of the birds are in chronic pain for the last couple of weeks of their lives because their legs basically can't support them. But they also can't sit down on the litter because the amount of ammonia in the litter is so high that they can get burns to their hocks from sitting on it. Ammonia forms an acid which provides burns. So that's just one example. I could go on, but I don't have a lot of time. But that's just one example in which clearly I think the meat industry is one that causes direct harm to a vast number of those who are not parties to the transaction in any real sense. Am I saying that therefore we should ban the sale of this product? I don't think that that's feasible, unfortunately, at this stage with the attitudes that prevail in this country or more or less any other country in the world. I think that is a process that will have to come more slowly, and I'm not really hopeful that it will come purely because of education either, any more than I'm hopeful that the demand for paid sex will be stopped by education. But I am hopeful that the development of alternatives to meat from animals will eventually render this industry unnecessary. Some of you might have read as a child, perhaps not so much now, a 19th century novel called Black Beauty by Anna Sewell about a horse in 19th century England whose life is miserable because she's a beast of burden. She's pulling carts, she's whipped, she's flogged, she has a very tough life. The cruelty of the carriage horses in the 19th century was not stopped by humane legislation, although maybe it helped a little. It was stopped by the invention of the internal combustion engine and the replacement of horses. I think the best prospect of ending the market for meat is the use of technology to develop alternatives that people find just as palatable to eat as meat, that is just as nutritious, healthier, I think it could easily be healthier, and economically competitive. And we already have a number of places working on that. One possibility that you might have heard of is growing meat at the cellular level in the lab, in vitro meat, which in principle would be really meat without having caused any animal suffering and would reduce the greenhouse gas emissions of meat by 97%. But there are also attempts to texture plant-based products. And in fact, some of you may have tasted faux chicken, which at least if we're talking about white meat chicken pieces, I'm not talking about a whole drumstick, but if we're talking about white meat chicken pieces, does a pretty good job. In fact, last year, Whole Foods, the supermarket chain, acknowledged that for about a month, it had mislabeled its faux chicken salad as chicken salad. Not a single customer complained. So we're getting there. And I hope that the writing is on the wall for the meat industry and that we will soon have market alternatives which will either eliminate or at least dramatically reduce the problems that I've just mentioned. I'm going to stop there because I want to leave you some time for questions and discussion. So thank you very much. We have people with mics. So if you want to ask a question, raise your hand and I'll point to you and somebody will bring the microphone to you. Thank you.
Questions? All right, right here.
How do you feel about the prospects?
Sorry, can you hold the microphone a little closer?
Yes. How do you feel about the prospects of insect?
Okay, try again. No, try it again.
How do you feel about the prospects of insect-based food options?
How do I feel about insect-based food options? I'm not sure, I have to say, is my answer to that. I'm not sure because I'm not sure whether insects are sentient beings. And in fact, it's possible that some insects can feel pain and some insects can't. After all, if we talk about insects, we're talking about an immense variety of species, much greater variety than birds and mammals, or even much greater variety than all vertebrates. So it's conceivable. Just I think this week there was a study published in Science which reported some experiments on bumblebees that suggested that they may have emotion-like states. It didn't say emotional states, it said emotion-like states, and it didn't say they were conscious states. So I'm not exactly sure what unconscious emotion-like states are like. But if you did get research showing that some insects were conscious, then I would be worried about producing insects for food. On the other hand, if you could have evidence showing that some insects were not conscious, then I would think this could be a good way of producing protein. I know that there is research going on in this area. I've heard of research using crickets, which might be, if any insects are conscious, among the upper end. And I've heard of research using mealworms, which from what I understand about the number of neurons they have, would be down the lower end. So it's possible that, you know, mealworms could be good and using crickets could have more difficult issues. I don't know, and it's going to be hard to know. So I prefer the plant-based foods if we have those options. Okay, let's come over this side of the room. Anyone here? There's a hand right at the back there. Yep.
Hi, thank you. Do you believe that those that are involved in the production of the meat market are obligated to stop producing?
I'm sorry, again, I didn't quite... Do I believe that those involved in the production of what? Of meat?
Of meat, or are secondarily involved in the market by making a living, should stop doing what they're doing? Or are obligated to stop?
Yeah. Well, look, I suppose if I hear that producers of meat, particularly of intensively farmed, factory farmed meat or animal products, decide to go out of that business and find something else, yes, I think that that's a good thing, because I think that there is, as I say, a lot of suffering there. If there is a producer of free range or more humanely produced meat going out of business, I'm not so sure that that's a good thing, because clearly what's happening, a number of different things are happening. There are some people who, because of what they read and hear about factory farming and the various undercover videos that are available online, move from eating factory farm products to eating more humanely raised animal products. And I consider that a good thing. I don't think it's ideal, but it's progress. We have to make progress step by step, so I welcome that progress. So, since those people might not move straight to plant-based foods, it's not a bad thing that they can move to the more humanely raised products. So I don't particularly encourage those producers to go out of business. I think they're filling a role that is useful, and if they do it as well as they can, they look after their animals conscientiously as well as they can, I would say at this stage of where society is at, they're probably serving a useful role and it's fine for them to stay in business. Okay, let's come down this side. You got someone there? Yeah.
Hi. I'm wondering how you would respond to what I think most feminist theorists categorize rape as a act against women in order to establish dominance or power. And therefore, if sex was legalized, then you would not have that establishment of power over women. I guess my question really stems from, you say that legalizing sex work would decrease rape, but if rape is an act of power or violence against women, then I guess how would legalizing it stop rapists from raping?
Yeah, it's a good question, but as I say, the study of Rhode Island suggested that it did have that effect, and if other good studies show that it has that effect, then I think you have to start questioning the idea that rape is simply the exercise of power over women without a sexual component. And I have to say, you know, when you think of it, that is a pretty counterintuitive idea, right? To sort of desexualize rape and simply see it as the exercise of power over women. Because after all, men could also exercise power over women by simply battering them insensitive, right? And sometimes that happens, of course. But the fact that rape occurs and it's not that men who rape do not always, you know, they're not, if you like, equally inclined to batter women insensible, suggests that there is something sexual going on. And I think, as I say, the studies that I've suggested support that. So without trying to simplify this issue, the motivations for rape might be complex, but I think it's a little too doctrinaire to just say rape has nothing to do with sex. It's only about power. I think it's probably very often about both, and if you provide outlets for the sexual desires, you don't eliminate it. Indeed, the study didn't show that it eliminated rape, of course, but you may reduce its incidence. Yes, down here. Yes, you. Just wait for the mic to come. Yes.
So since human is the last element in the food chain, so if we ban the meat industry, do you think we'd mess up with the nature?
Would it mess up human nature, you're asking?
Like just the nature, the environment in general, because just the next element have to eat the previous one.
Well, actually nothing really, I think, well, maybe I should qualify that. The meat, the livestock industry itself is a major force messing up nature, if you like, messing up the environment. In fact, apart from the generation of greenhouse gases, it's probably the major factor. Certainly, it's the major land-based factor. Nothing changes the landscape more than the livestock industry. Don't forget, you know, you may say, well, what about growing corn and wheat and soy and so on? Don't forget that the majority of the corn and soy produced in this country, as in many other countries, is fed to livestock. And that's an extremely wasteful process, because when beef cattle in a feedlot eat corn, we get back, when we eat the cow, we get back about 1/10 of the food value of the grain that has gone into them. So if we stop feeding grains and soy to animals, to livestock in factory farms, we would actually be able to reduce the amount of acreage that is under agriculture and still have a lot more grain to feed the world. So there's nothing natural or protective of nature about the modern livestock industry. You know, you can think about cattle grazing in a field. Again, driving down, I saw some presumably dairy cows grazing in a field, and you could say, well, that's protected that landscape. It's not a natural landscape, of course. It's cleared. It's not a forest, but it's protected that landscape to some extent, more than just a cornfield. But most of the livestock is not like that, and most of the grain is not like that. So it would, in fact, be a great benefit. And then there's also the water pollution that occurs through the livestock industry. The flushing of animal waste, of animal manure, into rivers has been a major cause of water pollution in this country and a major reason why people don't swim in major rivers very much anymore. It's also created a dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico, because it all goes down the Mississippi out into the Gulf of Mexico, where it causes the loss of oxygen in the areas, and hundreds of square miles of the Gulf of Mexico become dead because of that. So I think we would actually have a much better environment if we phased out the livestock industry. There's one here. We can come down here.
We've got one back here.
Oh, you got one back there? Yep. Good. Okay, let's take the one back there, and then we'll come to you.
Hi. If the sex industry were to become legal, how would you recommend they regulate it?
I'm sorry, I'm not hearing you yet, partly because people are walking out and it's making a little bit of noise. Partly maybe you need to get a little closer.
If the sex industry were to become legal, how would you recommend they regulate it?
Again, can you repeat it?
If the sex industry were to become legal, how would you recommend regulating it?
How would you recommend regulating? Yeah. So clearly, as I said, you have to regulate it in terms of the people involved being consenting adults. So the most important regulation is that you make sure that all of those involved are adults and that they have chosen to work in that industry, that they are not trafficked women, that they are not immigrants who've been brought in who are confined to that industry. Should you regulate it beyond that or not is an interesting question. And I think that that's still an open question. In Australia, which you might have worked out is where I'm from, we have contrasting models in the two largest states. So in Victoria, you can run a licensed brothel. You cannot legally be a street sex worker. So if you want to start a brothel, it's like starting any other business. You go to the government, you say, I want a license to operate a brothel at this particular premises. The local government will investigate. If you're next to a school, they won't do it. If it's in a solidly residential area, you won't do it because brothels tend to have traffic late at night. But if you're in an area where it's deemed not to cause a nuisance, they'll license it and you then run that business. You can be inspected, make sure that the workers are of age and are freely there and so on. But everything else is just like running a normal business. On the other hand, if you don't want to work in a brothel and you want to sell your sexual services on the street, you can be prosecuted for that, and so can your clients. So there's less of that. I wouldn't say there's none of it. There's less of it. Some of it still occurs. People don't want to pay a share to the brothel person running the brothel or something of that sort. But anyway, it happens. In New South Wales, on the other hand, there's really no regulation. It's a completely deregulated market, except for what I just mentioned about age and consent. So, and interestingly, the Australian Sex Workers Association prefer that model. They think that it's better because, as I said, there will still be some sex workers operating outside brothels under the brothel-only model. And if they get beaten up or they get cheated and the client doesn't pay, they're not going to be able to go to the police because they don't want to tell the police that they were working illegally. So, you can debate that question, but my inclination probably would be to go along with what the sex workers themselves say.
Okay, we have time for two more questions.
Two more, right. So we've got one down the front here, and you can pick one on your side of the room.
Hi. You said that the negative externalities associated with the interests of animals should, in addition to the environmental externalities, also be considered when considering legislation curbing the amount of livestock and poultry products. Do you think that considering that animals and those conditions owe their lives to those industries, that those and considering that animals have an interest in living, do you think those positive externalities should be considered as well?
Right. I think that's a very good question, and one that raises some quite deep philosophical issues. It's been debated and argued about a bit over recent years. Let me put it this way, without going into all the philosophical complexities, because we don't have time for that. I think if it's clear that the lives of the animals are positive, and if they are then killed humanely at the end of it, it's at least open to argue that there is a positive externality. That is, that they are brought into existence, that they have a good life, and that they wouldn't otherwise have had that life. It's also open to argue that you're still wronging them by taking that life prematurely. And it is always premature, of course, when you're talking about meat. Nobody wants to eat old, tough meat. And if you're talking about dairy or egg production, the rate of production drops off as the animals age. So again, no producer will keep them until they die of old age. So I would think that that's a difficult question to resolve, but as I said, it's defensible to argue in the way you suggested. So you could say that to that extent, my argument is targeted mostly at those cases where it seems pretty clear that the lives of the animals are not positive for them.
It seems like you start with the example of selling a kidney because someone can do perfectly fine without their kidney. What about a more extreme example of a self-injurious exchange where someone wanted to sell their eyes, or to take it to the extreme, if someone's family was in deep financial debt and they could commit an act of profitable suicide pretty much by selling all of their organs? Would that be permissible, or is it an issue that this could be encouraged?
Yeah, it's always a question of, you know, if you start talking about the free choice of consenting adults in the marketplace or elsewhere, how far do you want to take that? So as I said with regard to kidneys, I wasn't really arguing for a fully free market. I wasn't arguing that anybody just ought to be able to walk up to a kidney buyer and say, yeah, you can have my kidney right now. And then they just haggle about the price and you hand the price over in cash. I am more paternalistic than that, right? And that's why, as I said, I think at least what we should try is incentives that clearly are a long-term benefit, like healthcare cover, an annuity, a contribution to the retirement fund, priority for receiving organs, those sorts of things. So to that extent, if somebody says, I want to sell you my heart, or both my kidneys and my liver and my heart and my corneas, whatever, to benefit my family, I don't think that that's something that we ought to contemplate. We ought not to be aiding and abetting that. Now, I can imagine an argument for that. You could say, well, my family are in such dire situation that that's the only way I can get enough to get them out of it. So you could imagine that sort of extreme case. Fortunately, I think not in the United States, because even though our social security net is not very good, it's better than that. In some countries, conceivably, but still, I think we should stay away from those extremes. We should see where we can go with the more modified free market, more regulated market that I'm suggesting, and I think that would probably be enough to eliminate the waiting list, which is causing such loss of life.
Thank you all for coming out today. Please join me in thanking Professor Singer.